Hello students, welcome once more to online class for ICSE class 10th computer applications. In the last video we had discussed about loops in Java. That was only part 1 because loop is a very wide chapter. So in loop part 1 I had explained about what is loop, what are the elements that control a loop, in which we had discussed initialization expression, test expression, body of the loop and update expressions. Then types of the loop we had discussed, that is for, while and do while, with syntax and examples. After that, difference between while and do while we had discussed, and what is entry control loop and what is exit control loop. Now today's video is dedicated to the second part of the loop, in which we will discuss about jump statements in Java. In that we will cover return, break and continue, and we will also discuss about the different variations in the for loop. It means in how many ways for loop can be written or applied. There are 5 variations in the for loop, that is multiple initialization and update, optional expression, infinite loop, empty loop and declaration of a variable in the loop. So starting with the jump statement, with the name itself it is clear that jump statement means it will transfer the control from one part of the program to another part. In Java, we have 3 jump statements that transfers the control from one specific location to another location, and in between it leaves many statements. It means these statements will not run. So control will jump from one specific part to another part. So there are 3 jump statements in Java, that is return, break and continue. Return can be used anywhere in a program, whereas break and continue are used inside the smallest enclosings like loops. Let me tell you about break, that all you have already discussed in the switch case program. Break takes the control outside the switch block where it is used. So 2 more we will study here, that is continue and return. So return is dedicated to the method chapter. Here I will explain only the introduction of return statement. Now break and continue, these 2 statements are used inside loops. One more statement we have, system.exit, in bracket it receives a argument 0. It is used to break out of a program, but this system.exit we don't use quite often in programming. Always remember, break and continue are used inside loops, and break can be used in switch case also. Now one by one we will discuss it in detail, starting with return first. The statement which sends back the value or outcome from a method to the caller program is known as return statement. Sometimes when we design a function, then the logic used in the function we want to apply in another method or another program. So in that case we apply return statement. The outcome of the method or the result of the method, that will be any value, can be sent back to the caller program or caller method. For that purpose we use return statement. Its syntax is, we use the keyword return after that value. That value can be any value of any type, like byte, short, int, long, float, double, char, boolean, or string value. It depends from function to function. What is the result of the function? Accordingly, we return the value to the other method or other program. With this example, it will become more clear to you. Find the value returned when the given method CR executes for x equal to 125. First, see the program code here. I have designed this program in my system. Now see the code here. CR is the function. Its return type is not void. See the highlighted part here. Double is used here. Generally, we used void as the return type for any function. But in this case, double is used. It means whenever a function returns a value to the caller method. So according to the data type of the value, we write the data type as the return type instead of void. So double is the return type, CR is the method name. It receives a double value x. R will store the cube root of x and return keyword is used here, and what value we want to return, that we have written inside the math bracket. So R will store the cube root of x, and that value will be returned from this function CR. If we execute it, it will ask a value. Suppose we are entering 125 here. So you know cube root of 125 is 5. Since the function returns double value, so 5 will change to 5.0. So whenever you use return keyword or return statement in a method, function will return the value in a console box. Terminal window will not open here. Suppose we run this method again for different value. Suppose we have 8 here, cube root of 8, that is 2. So this time you can see 2.0 is returned. So that is the role of return statement. Now second jump statement is system.exit. Argument is used 0 here. It can receive any integer argument inside the bracket. You cannot keep the bracket empty, otherwise it will give error. So what is the role of this function? It will take the control outside the program. One example is given here. Or you can consider system.exit will terminate the program from the place where it is used. Class method is used. Now see, simple program I have used here. Print statement hello, then system.exit is used. Then again one more print statement Java. We are going to print hello and Java, but before Java we have used system.exit. So if we run this code, execution starts from top to bottom. So hello will print obviously on the terminal window. But when the control comes to this statement, its role is to take the control outside the program. Means program will terminate. So when program terminates, then Java will not print. So we will get the result only hello. Now see this program I have designed in my system. Same code. So first I will show you when we don't use this system.exit. I have used comment here, you can see. Now when we run this, we will get hello also and Java also. So you can see both the words are printed. Now if we remove this comment, now system.exit will also execute. Now in this case when we run the code, you can see it is printing only hello. So Java is not printed here. That is the role of system.exit. Now we will discuss break statement. The break statement enables a program to skip over part of the code. It terminates smallest enclosing while, do while, for or switch case. In switch case, you have already seen what is the role of break. It takes the control outside the switch block. But break can be used in loop also. All the loops, for, while and do while. So what is the role of break when it is used inside the loop? It will terminate the loop and execution resumes immediately following the body of the terminated statement. Means loop will terminate, but after loop, whatever you have written, that statements will run as it is. We will see this with some examples. See the program. Int I. Now normally this loop will run 10 times from 1 to 10. But in the body of the loop, if I modulus 3 equal to 0, then break. Break is applied with if condition. Whenever you use break or continue, always use it with any if condition. So when value of I will be divisible by 3, only then break will execute. And when the break will execute, from here a program will jump to outside the body of the for loop. So when it goes outside the body, then after break, whatever statements are written, that will not run. Since it is a jump statement. So see, first time when I is 1, 1 is less than 10, satisfied, then it will go inside the body. 1 is not divisible by 3, so break will not run. When break will not run, then this print statement will run. So we will get the value 1. After that, when it goes to update, I will become 2. Now 2 is less than or equal to 10, that is satisfied. Again it will go inside the body. For 2 also, if is not satisfied, so break will not run, so 2 will also print. So we have got two values, 1 and 2. So after the body, once more when I is updated, that is 3. So 3 is also less than or equal to 10. Satisfied. So third time also loop will run. But this time if is satisfied, 3 modulus 3 equal to 0. So break will run. So what break will do? It will take the control outside the for block. So for 3, it will go outside the block. It means 3 will not print here. So we will get only 1 and 2. Now see the result. We have got only 1 and 2. So break is, I think, clear for you. Now we will discuss about continue statement. Continue is also a jump statement like break, but instead of forcing termination, it forces the next iteration of the loop to take place, skipping any code in between. In break, we have seen it terminates the loop, but continue will not terminate the loop. It forces the next iteration of the loop. It means that particular iteration will stop, but next iteration will continue. This note is very important for you. Otherwise, you will have many doubts. As you know, continue is used only in loops, that is for while and do while. So always remember, when continue is used with for loop, it takes the control to update expression. Whereas when it is used with while or do while loop, it takes the control to test expression. Now see the example. Find the output of the given code. Let me clear the other programs. Now we will focus on continue. Now code is here. Same program I have used that was used with break. So normally the loop will run 10 times, that is from 1 to 10. And we are going to print the value of I. But which value of I will print, that will be decided by this if condition and continue. So starting with first value, when I is 1, initialization expression will run first, then it will go to test expression, 1 is less than or equal to 10, that is true, then it will go to the body of the loop. Now in the body of the loop, 1 modulus 3 equal to 0, that is false. When it is false, continue will not run, because continue is the body of if. So for I equal to 1, if condition fails, it means print statement will execute, so we will get the value 1. When I is 2, after the update, again 2 is less than or equal to 10, satisfied, again it will go to the body, again if does not satisfy, so continue will not run, 2 will also print. Now when I is 3, condition is true, but this time 3 modulus 3 equal to 0, now continue will execute. In the note you have seen, when continue is used with for loop, it will take the control to update expression. So for I equal to 3, when continue runs, from here it will jump to update. And during that process, it will leave other statements that are written outside continue. Means for value 3, continue will go to take the control to update. So I will become 4. It makes sure that 3 will not print. So 1, 2 we have got. For 3, continue will take it to update. So 3 will not print. After update, it will become 4. For 4 also, it will go to the body. For 4, if is not satisfied, so 4 will print. Similarly, for 5, if is not satisfied, 5 will also print. but when it is 6, for 6, if will satisfy, so continue will take the control to update. It means 6 will not print. So after update it will become 7. So you have seen whatever are the values of I that are divisible by 3, those values will not print. So from 1 to 10 you know that 3, 6 and 9, 3 values are divisible by 3. So these 3 values will not print, other values will print. Now see the result. One, two, three is not printing, 4, 5, 6 is not printing, 7, 8, and 9 is not printing. I think continue should be clear to you now. So far we have discussed all the 4 jump statements, break, continue, return and system.exit. Now we will discuss the different variations of the for loop. It means for loop can be used in how many ways. There are 5 different ways in which for loop can be written. So one by one we are going to discuss that. First variation is multiple initialization and multiple update expressions. It means we can initialize many values and we can update many values or variables inside a for loop. But when you use multiple initialization and update, always separate the variables with comma. Now see the example. I and A are 2 variables, both integer type. Now in the for loop you can see I equal to 1 comma. This comma is very important here. It is used to separate the multiple initialization. So there are 2 initializations here, I equal to 1, A equal to 20. So initialization expression has 2 variables that are initialized. After that, we use semicolon to separate initialization with test expression. Now the test expression is I less than or equal to 5. So till the value of I is less than or equal to 5, this loop will run. Again, semicolon will terminate or separate test expression with update. So after this we have update. You can see I have used 2 update expressions because there was 2 initialization, so I plus plus and A equal to A minus 4. Value of I will increase by 1 every time and value of A will decrease by 4. So between these 2 updates, again this comma is compulsory. So comma is used to separate the update and initialization. Now see what will be the output of the given code. First we will see which variable is controlling the loop. First see the test expression. Test expression will control the loop. So I is controlling the loop here till it is 5 or less. So starting value of I is 1, last value is 5 and update for I is I plus plus. It means loop will run 5 times, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. But what we are doing in the body of the for loop, we are only printing the value of A. So first time when I is 1, A is 20. 1 less than or equal to 5 condition is true. After that it will go to the body. It will print the value of A, that is 20. After the body is executed, then it will go to update expression. In update, it will execute from left to right. First I will update, so I will become 2. Then A will update, so A will become 16. Previous value was 20, so 4 will be deducted. So this time I is 2, A is 16. After that it will again check the test condition. 2 is less than or equal to 5. Again true. Now it will go to the body. So it will print value of A, that is 16. So this loop will run 5 times. And every time it will print the value of A. So first value is 20 for A. So 20 will print. Next time 4 is deducted, so 16. After that 16 minus 4 we will get 12. 12 minus 4 we will get 8. And 8 minus 4 we will get 4. So 5 times loop will run. Now see the result. Loop will run 5 times and every time it will print the value of A, starting with 20, and every time value of A will be reduced by 4. That was the first variety of for loop. Now the second variation of for loop is optional expression. In a for loop, initialization expression, test expression and update expression are optional. It means we can skip any of these expressions or we can skip all of these expressions. So out of three expressions, any one we can leave, two we can leave or all three we can leave. See the code, how it can be used. I have design three separate examples to explain it. Starting with the first example, you can see here I equal to 1. Now see, in the initialization expression nothing is written here. We will simply use one space. Test expression, I less than or equal to 5, and update, 2 is added in I. But when you don't initialize a value in the variable, be careful, it should be done before the loop. So what I have done, I equal to 1, I have written before the loop, that will behave as initialization expression. So first value I is 1. When it goes to initialization expression here, then nothing will happen here, so I will remain 1. Now 1 is less than or equal to 5, that is true. Then it will go to the body. So I will print, that is 1 will print. Then it will go to update. I will become 3. Now 3 less than 5. Again it will go to body. 3 will print. Then it will become 3 plus 2, that is 5. So for 5 also it will satisfy. Then 5 will also print. So 1, 3, 5 we have got. Now value of I is 7. 7 less than or equal to 5, that is false. When it is false, then loop will terminate. So control will go outside this method block. So we will get only 1, 3 and 5. That was the first optional expression where we had left the initialization part. Now we will see second way of writing optional expression. see the code here. I equal to 10, that is byte type. Initialization, nothing is there. Test expression is used and update is not used. So what will happen here? First value I equal to 10, it will go to initialization, nothing will happen here. Then it will check the condition, 10 is greater than or equal to 1, that is true. So when condition is true, then it will go to the body. So we will get the value 10. So after printing 10, it will go to update, but in update we don't have any expression. It means value of I will remain as it is, that is 10. Again it will check the condition, 10 is greater than or equal to 1, that is true. Then again it will go to the body, so it will print 10 again. So two times we have got 10. After printing 10, again it will go to update, again no update, so I will remain 10. So 10 more than 1. So you can see value of I will not update, so I will remain 10 every time, and every time 10 will be more than 1. So every time condition will be true. It means body of the loop will run every time, and every time 10 will print. That is the example of infinite loop, because loop will not stop since the value of I is not changing. Now we will see the result. Same code we have, that I have just now explained. Now we will directly see the result. Now you can see it is printing 10 every time. It will not stop. That is infinite loop. So be careful when you want to close the terminal window from here. See, I am trying to close it with cross button, but it will never close. So to stop the infinite loop, see what I am doing here. You just have to open the project window. On the left hand side, at the bottom, you can see a red color horizontal strip is running here. See the arrow. This red color horizontal strip, when it is moving from left to right, it means program is executing. Just now you have seen, still program is running, 10 is printing. So to stop it, we need to right click on this strip and select Java, reset Java virtual machine. After clicking it, now see the color of this strip changes from red to gray. It means execution of program has stopped. Now when you open the terminal window, now you can clear it also and you can close it also. It will close. So you have seen the example of optional expression in which two expressions were left. Initialization was left and update was left. Now we will see third example. See here, I have not used initialization, I have not used test expression, and I have not used update expression. So all three expressions can be left. Byte type variable I have taken, you can take any type. There is no use of variable because we are not printing the value of I here. We are printing the name. I am printing my name here. Now see, the execution will start from initialization expression. So here you can see nothing is initialized in the variable. Then it will go to test condition. No test condition. See, the test condition is just like a watchman that is standing in front of the main gate of any restaurant or hotel of or your house. What is the role of watchman? To avoid the unwanted persons to get entry. So when a watchman is standing outside a hotel, it will stop the unwanted persons or unwanted people in the hotel. In the same way, when we use test expression decides whether the control will go to the body or not. So imagine a situation when there is no watchman outside a 5-star hotel. It means all the persons can get entry into the hotel. Even the animals can get entry into the hotel if nobody is there to stop. So in that case, dogs, goats, all the animals can get entry. In the same way, when you don't use test expression. So for every iteration, the control will get entry into the body of the loop. So in the body of the loop, I am printing my name. So every time it will go to the body. So how many times it will run? It will run infinite times because there is no test expression. So whenever you don't have test expression, then loop will automatically become infinite loop. Now see, I am going to run it. In this case, we don't have initialization, test and update. Now you can see my name is printing every time and it will continue infinite times. So to stop it, just now I have told you, right click on the red color strip in the project window and select reset Java virtual machine. Now the loop is terminated. Now it can be cleared and closed here. So optional expression you have seen. There were three examples of optional expression. Now we will see third variation of the for loop. That is how to create infinite loop. There is one very simple method to create infinite loop. Whenever the test expression is missing in the loop, it will automatically become infinite loop. So by omitting test expression, infinite loop can be created. But there are some other ways also to create infinite loop. And how to stop infinite loop, that I have already told you. So we will see the example here. Find the output of the given code. Now see, initialization I have written here, I equal to 1. No test expression, no update expression. So first value I is 1. Because of absence of test expression, it will go to the body. So what will happen? 1 will print. And after printing 1, it will go to update. But there is nothing in the update. So value of I will remain 1. Again, no test expression. So again, it will go to the body. Again, 1 will print. Again, it will go to update. No update. Again, test expression, no. test expression, so again one will print. So one will print infinite times. Now we will see the result. It is already running there. Let us open the window. Yes, you can see one is printing infinite times. So again, I am going to stop it. Now clear the terminal window. So three variations of for loop we have seen: multiple initialization and update, optional expression, and infinite loop. Now the fourth variation is empty loop or null loop or bodyless loop. With the name itself, it is clear: bodyless. A loop which does not has any statement in the body is known as bodyless loop or empty loop or null loop. It means we have not given any instruction in the body, so no task will be performed. That is the meaning of empty loop. With example, we will see. Find the output of the given code. You can see the loop will run 10 times normally, starting with 1, going up to 10, and I plus plus means from 1 to 10, all the natural numbers are covered. So our question is, how many times this loop will run and what will be the value or the result or the output? So when I is 1, initialization will run first, then it will go to test. 1 less than or equal to 10, that is satisfied. It will go to the body. Now you can see in the body, between the pair of braces, nothing is written. It means no instruction is given in the body, so nothing will happen. So after that, it will go to update. I will become 2. For 2 also condition is true, again it will go to the body, but nothing will happen here. For 3 also same thing. So for 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, all 10 times loop will try to execute the body, but there is no statement to execute. So process will continue. Loop will run 10 times. But nothing will happen, no result. When I becomes 11, for 11 the condition will become false. Now the loop will terminate for I equal to 11. Now it will go outside the body of the for loop. Means here. Here we are printing the value of I. So the last value for which the loop has been terminated, that is 11. Only that value will print. Let us see the result. You have seen 11 is printing here. So that was empty loop. One more example of empty loop. See, the same code I have written, but after the bracket of the for loop, instead of pair of braces, I have used this semicolon. Generally, we don't use semicolon after the bracket of the for loop. But sometimes, if we use semicolon after the bracket of the for loop, by knowingly or by mistake, so what will happen? You can see one statement is here. If we don't write this semicolon, then this statement will behave as body of the loop. But when we use semicolon here, then this semicolon itself will behave as body of this for loop. You have studied null statement. When we simply put semicolon, then it is a null statement, but there is no instruction given. So semicolon will behave as body of the loop and it will behave as null statement. Now see what will be the output of the above code. First time I is 1, 1 is less than or equal to 10, that is true. Now it will try to go to the body. It will search the body. So how the for loop finds the body? It will search where is semicolon after this bracket. So if we write semicolon just after the bracket, it will find the semicolon here itself. Then it will consider it as body. And since it is a null statement, no instruction will be performed. So it will behave as empty statement. So nothing will happen. And control will not go to the next line, because this statement is outside the body. Be careful about this. When the body executes, nothing will happen. Then it will go to update. I will become 2. For 2 also, condition is true. Again it will go to the body. So it will find semicolon as body. Nothing will happen. Then for I equal to 3, same process will run for all the values of I from 1 to 10. So loop will run 10 times, but nothing will happen. When I becomes 11, this time loop will terminate. Then it will go outside the body of the for loop. So it will leave this semicolon, it will go outside the body, so this statement will run. So value of I will print, that is 11. So in previous case also we had seen the result was 11. In this case also we will see the same result as 11. So to create empty loop there are two methods. One method is after the bracket you can use pair of curly braces and nothing should be written inside the bracket. Second example, if you don't want to use pair of braces, then you can simply put semicolon after the bracket. It will behave as empty loop. Now see the result. Same 11 we will get. Now the last variety of for loop. Declaration of variable inside a for loop. In Java, a variable can be declared within a for or while loop condition statement. But when you declare a variable inside the for loop, always remember one thing. Scope of variable you have studied in the beginning. It means a variable can be accessed only in the block where it has been declared into. So when you declare a variable inside a for loop, always remember that that variable can be used only in the for loop. It cannot be used outside the for loop. If you want to use that variable outside the for loop, it will give syntax error. Now we will see with the example. See this code carefully. Here I is declared inside the bracket. In the previous examples, I used to declare I before the for loop, but this time it is declared inside the for loop. So whenever you declare it, this value of I can be used only in the for loop. It cannot be used outside the for loop. So I equal to 1, I less than 10, I plus equal to 3. After that, body of the loop printing I. This is the body of the loop. Before this example, I had told you, after the for loop, compiler will try to find out where is semicolon to decide the body of the for loop. So it will find semicolon here. Because of this semicolon, this statement will behave as body of the for loop. In the comment also I have written here, this is the body of the for loop. Now what about the second statement? Since we have two statements after the for loop and curly braces are not mentioned, in that case only the first statement will behave as body of the loop. Second statement will not behave as body of the loop. Now see, we are going to print the value of I. This value we are printing in the body of the for loop, but this value of I we are printing outside the body of the for loop. What is the scope of this variable I? It is declared inside the for loop. So this value of I can be used in the body of the for loop. Here it will work. Here it will not give error. But in this statement, it will give error. So when we click on compile button, you can see it will give error. So your answer will be syntax error. Now see the name of the error. Cannot find the symbol variable I. It means compiler is saying that variable I is not declared, but you can think that we have declared it, but you have declared the variable in the for loop, so it cannot be used outside the for loop. That is the reason. Now see the second example. Same example I have used, but I have removed one statement after the body. So in this case, with the for loop, we have only one statement in the body. Now this I can be used. Since the variable is declared inside the for loop, so it can be used in the for loop. So when we run this, first value I is 1, then it will check the condition 1 less than 10, that is true, then it will go to body, it will print 1, next time I will become 4, now 4 is less than 10, that is true, so 4 will also print, then I will become 7, 7 also less than 10. 7 will also print. So we have got 1, 4 and 7. Now I is 10. 10 less than 10 is not true. So loop will terminate. So we will get only 1, 4 and 7. So when we run this code, we have got 1, 4 and 7. So that's all for today. We have covered all the things in the loop. I hope you would have studied and understood it. In the next video, I will explain the programs related with for loop, while loop, and do while loop. Till then, revise all the things. Take care. Thank you.